Being through live real-time broadcast at www.youtube.com/user/Barnstable County. Meeting documents are available in advance at https://www.capecod.gov/county-government/meeting-center/. The County of Barnstable does not discriminate in the administration of its programs or activities on the basis of race, color, religion, natural origin, disability, age, sex, sexual orientation, gender identity, or other category protected by state and federal anti-discrimination laws and regulations. Reasonable accommodations for people with disabilities are available upon request. For more information or to file a complaint, please contact Justina Marzak, Barnstable County, ADA/Non-Discrimination Coordinator at jmarzak@barnstablecounty.org or call 508-375-6646 or visit www.barnstablecounty.org. Members of the public may also attend the meeting remotely through Microsoft Teams. Meeting ID number is 278-780-824-134, passcode 54, capital P, capital W, lowercase z, lowercase f, or call in audio only 781-469-0191, phone conference ID 768-675-958. Is there anyone who is recording this meeting other than IT? Okay. With that, I'd like a moment of silence to honor our troops who have died in service to our country and all those serving our country in the armed forces. And I'd like to rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, please. Owen, are you gonna lead us?
I can. I pledge allegiance to the flag, the United States of America, and to the Republic, for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Please call the roll, Mr. Clerk.
Sure. Delegate Chafee?
Here.
Chair Green?
Here.
Delegate Gallagher?
Here.
Delegate Warner?
Here.
Delegate Wyman Colombo? Madam Chair, you have got a quorum with everyone in attendance.
That's great. Thank you very much, Mr. Clerk. So when I called this meeting, I spoke with Owen and I asked for an hour to meet. And I thought it was going to be simple and far less time than an hour. But once I got into the weeds of this budget, I realized I perhaps made a mistake. I would like to go quickly over some of the issues I found when I really started to dig into the budget. And I prepared a spreadsheet that was really just a worksheet to guide conversation and perhaps even expedite the conversation. But I'm just going to hit the highlights first of what my thinking was and then open it up to members of the committee and others. So the first thing is that the budget overall is a reduction in 3.34%, whereas some of the other departments even have increases. This department is very heavy on staff, and a huge amount of the budget is devoted to staff. And thankfully, none of the excellent staff members of this department were cut, but it gave the department head, I believe, very little wiggle room. In fact, I've listened to the commissioners' meeting and attended our meetings, and that's what I heard the director say. In addition to that, there's about $100,000 in rent that this department pays, but other departments are not charged because they use our county facilities. The only other entity is the Cape Cod Commission that pays rent for a building. The third thing is, I think it's really hard for us to talk about staff retention, and especially of the excellent employees in this department, some of which, a number of which are nationally known, and the issues we're having with hiring excellent staff. And then at the same time, see that the department had nowhere else to go except to cut education and travel, pretty much related to education, is if I understand correctly. The fourth thing is that there are services to all of our communities that were cut, and they, in my estimation, cost very little, relatively speaking, especially to the whole budget. One is shellfish, other is the Bifrost Bi-Local, the Lyme disease study, and hazardous waste. And unfortunately, those were areas that were impacted. The fifth item is professional and technical services that support staff initiatives, and there are a little bit of money that go a really long way. The sixth thing is AmeriCorps, which is sort of its own animal. We have, I believe, six buildings, and $50,000, I don't think, is a lot of money to be spent on these six buildings, which we all know are in disrepair. They're certainly not going to show up in Architectural Digest, that's for sure. But to cut that in half has to be a hardship. I think we're trying to encourage people to join AmeriCorps and serve for a year. And I don't think it's fair to cut that in half. The other thing that Kat had said to us was that she would like three people at $2,000 each to attend the national conference, and that is $6,000. I did not see a line item in our, what we received in our budget information that had that in it. I don't know if it's a combination of some of the other amounts, but I just wrote another line in there with a question mark and added that into the budget because I think that's important. I think other assembly delegates have expressed the importance of various items that I've gone over in various meetings. But as far as I'm concerned, the assembly has $100,000 in our budget to cover future requests. That's what the finance director told us. I'd be fine if that went into the this department budget and instead of hanging out there in order to cover future requests, financial requests. Or I would be also fine to ask the administration to explore other options with the budget. So at least, in my estimation, at least $150,000 is put back into this department budget and for the administration to find another place for it to be taken out of or find a solution and for the administration to report back to the assembly about that. What I red flagged was almost $160,000 that I really think should go back in. And I had two additional proposed proposals for this committee to consider anyway. And the version three is $117,000. I'm really open to hearing what the rest of this committee has to say, as well as any other delegates who happen to be on the line, and then anybody from the public. So what I'd like to do is open up the floor to members of the committee to ask questions of, I don't know if anybody from administration is here.
I believe I do see Chair,
yep.
Chair Green. Oh, I do see Kat Groffley and Mike.
Administrator Albert is here on the call, and Carol Coppola is here. Is Mr. McGuire, and Mr. McGuire is here as well to ask questions of of those attendees, as well as to voice opinions. And then I'll move on to members of the assembly at large and members of the public. Okay, I see Delegate, our Vice Chair Chafee. I'd like to recognize Vice Chair Chafee.
Thank you, Chair Green. This is, I think, a really important committee meeting to take a look at the impact of proposed cuts. And I'd like to, if we could through the chair, invite Commissioner Albert to make a few comments in general, especially for members of the public who may be watching this and aren't aware with the overall goals of the county budget this year. Can you just tell us the direction that you provided to the Cooperative Extension about how they needed to shape their budget this year based on the overall county's budget goals?
Certainly, I'll be happy to begin. So when the budget message came out, we asked departments to go in and look at each of the lines in their budget to see, in looking at historical utilization, and identify areas where they might be able to make reductions or increases depending on utilization. So we wanted to present the most accurate budget that we could. That was the general message given to all department heads. In addition, there were the increases across the board in utilities, increases across the board in group health insurance, et cetera. All of those directions were given to department heads. We also did work on the revenue side, identifying revenue, right? Because my job, even though it's not in the charter, is to provide a balanced budget, right? So revenue, estimated revenue, has to equal expenses. And so, again, we start this process in November. Departments do their best. They look through their budget. We meet with each of the departments and go over line by line, identify areas that, you know, maybe that need to be looked at a little bit more closely, and then departments enter their budget. At that point, our finance director and I had been working on the revenue projections. Departments were putting in their budgets, and we realized there was about a $1.1 million difference between expenses and revenue. As I explained, our salary and group health insurance continues to rise, right? We provided employees with a 3% COLA last year, or this current year, I should say, as well as anyone who's eligible for a step increase based on performance gets a 3% step increase. And so some employees, some county employees, between the COLA and the step increase, saw their salary increase by 6% during this year. So, you know, our salary and fixed costs with group health insurance continue to rise, and our revenue has leveled out. These were the projections for revenue for FY24, is that we're going to be seeing a leveling out of revenue. So you may recall last year, the administration and finance also submitted a balanced budget. At that point, the assembly felt the budget was too large, or the increase was too significant, and the assembly itself made about $1 million, a little bit less than $1 million in reductions. This year, it's the other way. We submitted a balanced budget, looking at projected revenue and projected expenses. And we had to, before I presented the budget to the commissioners, we did ask department heads to go in and make reductions totaling, like I said, $1.1 million. We did that based on the percentage, the overall percentage of the department's portion of the operating fund. So larger departments did have a larger request for reductions. We did instruct department heads to go back in and look and come up with a list of reductions. I felt that that was a preferable option rather than having finance and administration go in and make cuts, because department heads know their budgets very well. And so, you know, there was an exercise, we went through it, and you, so then you have before you where those reductions took place. And again, it's based on a balanced budget, looking at our projected revenues, knowing that we're going to have, and I think I mentioned this, I mean, about 71% of our overall operating budget is for salary and benefits. So we're going to be, you know, seeing that continue to grow, and we're seeing a leveling of revenue. And so we're at a time where, you know, we're going to need to tighten our belts. And so department heads were asked to tighten their belts where they thought they could withstand. They were not, no one's happy with it, making that request or coming up with those solutions. But it was done in a manner that we thought would have the least impact on services. And so I will, hopefully that answered your question.
That's helpful. And if I may, Madam Chair, just follow with one comment on that. The, you know, we know the community on the Cape really values what the cooperative extension does. And I've heard a number of folks express concern in particular about the zeroing out the $30,000 for shellfish assistance. And when I look at the county budget schedule and towns like Brewster, who as of last week wasn't aware this was potentially going to be cut, we're in the middle of the budget process too, and that's going forward. So it could really be a significant problem for the towns to find out that they're not going to have this type of assistance, as an example, and be going through their own budget process and not be able to resolve the issue. So I'm very concerned in particular about that one. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. I don't see any other hands raised. Yeah, as far as committee members are concerned, are there other delegates at large who would like to ask questions or express opinions? I don't see anybody else. Okay, I do see a committee member's hand raised. Delegate Warner.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I too did speak to a number of people since the budget came out about the areas where items were considered being cut for the upcoming upcoming year. And overall, the consensus was that they would hope that some areas, and I'll identify the two that came up most frequently, that they would like to see if there couldn't be other ways determined to somehow keep either the entire amount in the back in the budget and or to to find another way to solve the problem that doesn't reduce make the reductions as large as they're proposed. And those areas were the shellfish seeds program, the buy fresh, buy local, and the AmeriCorps budget, both the I don't know if you call it the repair line, the amount that was reduced in half from 50,000 to 25,000, and also the ability for three of the members to be able to participate in the national conference and bring back ideas and concepts that they learned there over the period. And I did get a letter from one Yarmouth resident who had indicated that there were several items that she was concerned about, and those were among them, and that she felt that the value and service that to the communities was greater than that to consider cutting in the way that they were being proposed, and asked that they be reconsidered. So and that was Rosemarie Stripoli. So I think it's important that we see if there are not ways that we can look at this. I know that that $150,000 is a lot to try to put back into the budget or ask that it be put back and then replaced with something else. But perhaps there's a combination of the several items that you had suggested that that would be able to be done and palatable to move forward to the Finance Committee from the this group. So thank you.
Thank you, Delegate Warner. Are there any, okay, I see Delegate, you know, something, you're new, Colombo.
Michaela Colombo.
Is that Delegate Colombo? I'd like to recognize you, please. Go ahead. I think you're muted. Delegate Colombo, please go ahead. You're muted.
She doesn't seem to be able to unmute from her side.
Can Ian, can you help her, please?
We can't unmute. She's going to have to, if you press Control Shift M, it might do it for you. Control Shift M.
Okay, why don't I move on? Are there any members of the public who would like to speak? Or, and maybe we can come back to Delegate Colombo when she's able. I see Robert Duncanson. Could you please state your name and town, please? And go ahead.
Yes, hopefully you can hear me.
I can.
Okay, yes, Dr. Robert Duncanson, I'm Director of Health and Natural Resources for the Town of Chatham. And I just wanted to speak to the proposed reduction in the shellfish program. As you folks are probably well aware, Chatham has one of the largest, in fact, the largest shellfishery in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. We have several hundred commercial shellfishermen, as well as close to 1,000 recreational permits every year. And even though the funding from the county is not a huge amount of money, it is critical to the towns. And I'm really speaking not just for Chatham, but also the other Cape communities as co-chair of the Barnstable County Coastal Resources Committee. You know, we rely on that county money every year. As I said, it's not a huge amount, but it definitely helps continue these programs for the benefit of all our residents, as well as the many visitors that come to Cape Cod. And as one of the earlier speakers noted, you know, we're already, our budgets for FY 20, for the current and the proposed fiscal year have already been finalized. So, you know, it's really late in the game for us now to suddenly hear that the county funding that's been there for many, many years now and is relied upon in shellfish programs may not be coming forth next year. You know, and I fully understand the budget implications and, you know, the necessity of cuts. I mean, we go through that at the municipal level, you know, every year. So I fully understand that. But this is a program that's really utilized by a lot of people. It's relied upon by a lot of the towns. And honestly, you know, coming so late in the budget season, it's the timing is not at all good. And so with that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Duncanson. We appreciate you logging in and making your point of view known. May I try to see if Delegate Wyman Colombo is can unmute?
I'm working with her, Chair, so we'll see.
Okay. Mr. Clerk, would you let me know if you are able to move forward in that domain?
I will do that.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who has questions? Okay. Here we go. Is she all set? No. Okay. As far as the conversation is concerned, as far as the will of the committee, I'm curious if the will of the committee is to recommend that make a proposal to recommend to the Assembly Standing Committee on Finance that the fiscal year 2024 proposed budget of the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension be increased by a certain amount, or that someone would like to make a motion for the administration to explore other options to restore money to this particular department budget. Is okay. Well, I guess there are no committee members that are interested in speaking to this, but I see Delegate Harder. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm curious. There's two things that I'm not understanding what exactly their purpose is. Okay. One is the professional and technical service for $15,000 under Marine. What has that going from 30 to 15? What effect has that had?
I'd like to ask the department head, McGuire, to respond to that, please.
Sure. Mike McGuire, Director, Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. Okay, Delegate Harder, that particular line was reduced from $45,000 to $30,000, and the funds that are utilized in that marine program are predominantly for vendors and contractors that we utilize in our water quality monitoring and testing program for the marine program, and for our shellfish disease monitoring and testing. There are many different funds that get utilized for those purposes, including grant funds, but that is the county's line that typically addresses those. And in speaking with our staff, you know, we were going to try to utilize grant funds to the best of our ability. I did lean in pretty heavily on that line to make the reduction.
Okay, great. And so that's the and the $30,000 is the straight miscellaneous contractual shellfish. That's the shellfish. That's the entire shellfish feed. That's so hard for me to say. Shellfish feed program.
Right, so the $30,000 has been in there for a while, a long time. And so that is the entire county's share of the shellfish propagation program. And the logic behind that is $2,000 to each of the 15 towns, which is where we ended up with the 30.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, and I see Delegate O'Malley has his hand up. Please go ahead, Delegate.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Lower my hand. I'm interested in hearing from Mr. McGuire, from your perspective of the cuts you've had to make, what you see as the impact, what is going to be the most disruptive? Clearly, you've had to cut in a lot of areas, some of them relatively minor, and I'm sure we can always shuffle a little bit, but there are some of them that are substantial. What is that going to mean? What services that we have been accustomed to delivering? You've mentioned the shellfish propagation. I don't know if there's an end run for that you can envision, but I'm most interested in exploring what the meaning is going to come, what's going to happen with these cuts, and how critical is that? I think before we even start, where do we put money back in? Let's understand as best as we can what it's going to do. Let me leave it with that.
It's a great question. I would like to frame it in the context of, I just want one small comment, which is, I think we've been doing budget hearings for 11 years with the county, usually 2 to 4 or 5 a year. This is one of the more challenging ones for me, because I really want to acknowledge that there are many departments that were impacted by reductions. And, I understand that there's a finite resource, and I just want to be very careful with how I articulate this, because I think there's a lot of needs that in many departments. I think when we were asked to do the reductions, the priority was, okay, we were in agreement, we're not going to let staff go. And we were in agreement that there's certain fixed costs. And if you read in the budget book, I think on page 75, I put a little narrative together. It's just over $400,000 in non-salary and fringe. If you take the rental costs out and the early retirement cost, fixed costs out, it's like $150,000. So I really only had around $250,000 to look at to make reductions. And so the strategy that I used was, where are the grant funds that are available that I could potentially lean into in the future to help offset costs that I don't know if these grants will come in or not. I believe they will. I'm hoping they will. And I targeted reductions in areas I thought perhaps we could get state funding for or other grant funding for in the upcoming year. And then the attempt that I made was to shave off portions of most of these lines without totally wiping them out. There are a few that get hit heavily, and I would comment on those. And so I think there's been the most discussion about the shellfish propagation funds. That is a longstanding source of funding. It goes directly to the towns, and it supplements the state funds that come in that go to each of the towns. And there's a lot of value to those, certainly for maintaining healthy shellfish stocks, for water quality and natural resource management and our natural heritage. So there is a, and we've talked a lot about that. So maybe I'll move past that. Some of the other reductions, the education of employees, that line typically has had $10,000 in it. I reduced it to $2,000 with the hope that, maybe in the coming years we could kind of chip away and put a little bit more money in there. I did reduce the out-of-state travel budget. I zeroed that out with the understanding that there are grant funds that will pay for some of our staff to travel out of state. That one would, it's small numbers, but if you look at most of the reductions, the attempt was to take small portions out of portions of the budget out proportionally, that they would accumulate, add up to this larger reduction. So the professional and technical funds that we took out of marine and out of our horticulture programs, I did reduce. We've had $10,000 in a physicians forum line for a long time that we do. We educate physicians on tick-borne disease. Because of COVID, we had not had a forum in a while, so that there was a line that was being under expended. We are planning on doing one this year, and I left $3,000 in there for next year. Reduced it from 10 to 3, so that was a $7,000 reduction. I was hoping that perhaps I could collaborate with another agency and make it work in the following year. Every cut was difficult. These were not simple ones. I think the $25,000 reduction to the AmeriCorps facilities, you know, if that, that's, if you ask Kat, she's on the call, I think that's our number one priority there to examine. But again, I'm conscious that every single dollar that goes into restoring these is, has to come from somewhere else. And so I'm just trying to really moderate my tone on this, because I think, you know, we've got so many other needs, and you know, it's a real challenge. This was very difficult. These decisions were pretty difficult, but I think it was pretty hard for all the directors, and certainly for Beth and Carol. So I'd be happy, you know, that there were things that we made small reductions on. I'm going to change a contract with our photocopier and get a different one, and I mean, these small ticky tacky things, but you, if the big priorities, you know, you want to hear my opinion, probably the shellfish seed. I think there's going to be a lot of interest in that. The facility improvements at the AmeriCorps house, maybe a little bit back towards education of employees out of state travel, you know, that kind of, those kind of things, those would be helpful and a little professional and technical to put back into some of those lines that were cut a little bit deeper than I'd hoped. As far as what services will be affected or impacted, my goal is always where there's a will, there's a way. I'm going to chase funds. We're going to get creative. We're going to do what we always do to continue to find ways to provide these services. The difference next year is, you know, we're I don't have the funds in hand right now. We were typically, I would, with, from the county. So it's just, you know, it's a different operating model, but I can't think of one particular thing that we're not going to do because of these cuts. It's just with the exception of the shellfish seed. But, you know, it was attrition by 1,000 cuts, you know, just try to take a little here, a little there, and hopefully that it would add up to enough.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that response. I recognize how difficult it is, and I think the departments have done a marvelous job this year in adhering to the guidelines set down by the administration. And I know these cuts are difficult. And I simply want to be sure from our standpoint that we're understanding what that's going to mean, what these cuts are going to mean. And, you know, there's no easy way to restore them all. There may not be easy way to restore anything, but we really ought to know what we're doing as we go forward. So thank you very much, Director McGuire.
You're welcome. Thank you, Delegate O'Malley. And I'd like to recognize Deputy Speaker Potash, who is her hand.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll be brief. I appreciate your preparedness, Madam Chair, for this meeting. That document was extremely helpful, and it helped guide everybody. And I also want to extend gratitude to Dr. Robert Duncanson, who had the foresight to speak, not just for the town of Chatham, but based on his experience, he was able to speak for the entire Cape as to the impact on that. Most importantly, the idea that this is way late down the road. And when you think about the impact, not just about the monetary impact on towns, but just how that looks to towns, you know, when they've relied on the county for something, even a small thing. So I think that's certainly important what he said, and I appreciate him coming. And I'm sure the other towns do as well. And I also lastly want to say that I think Mr. McGuire just summed up four particular avenues that might be suggested for relief. And this committee obviously doesn't have to worry about where to get the money from. So you don't have to worry about the concept of rob Peter to pay Paul. You just have to talk about what it means to you. And then down the line, that'll all get addressed by everybody, really. So again, thank everybody for their hard work, and I'll leave you with that.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker Potash. I would like to ask at this time, I mean, Director McGuire, do you have anything further you'd like to say about the budget as we're looking at it and explain any aspect of the reductions that you feel are important to go back into the, I think you've done a good job answering Delegate O'Malley's question, but is there anything further you'd like to say?
I appreciate your faith in the department, and you know, we do really strive every year to bring in additional resources and match the resources that the county puts in our budget to bring them back in. And there's a lot of things that were reduced here, and I think if there is an opportunity for you to restore funding in some of those lines, that it's greatly appreciated. And we're going to keep doing what we've been doing. And I do think this just, you know, is one of those things where we have to look at the short-term and long-term impacts. I do think a lot of these things can be sustained in the short term through some creative processes, but I do think the longer term impact and what I'm looking at is, you know, what should we be signaling and signifying to the projects that we're working on, the communities we're working with, you know, and what direction is this heading? If we're going to reduce resources in one area, you know, for the short term, for 1 year, that's one thing. If it's going to be a trend where we kind of phase out of something, you know, then that's more strategic planning. And I think, you know, that's where I'm at now with it is, okay, we know things are going to be tight. Where are we going to go with certain projects? And I'll be focused on that approach in the upcoming year.
I appreciate that input. I too am concerned that not only would I see reductions this year, but are you going to be asked next year to reduce even further? I mean, that would be very concerning for me. I know that I've been on this standing committee for a number of years, and I think one of the first years I was a delegate, or maybe not the first year, but at the beginning of the time I've been serving, there was a point where the commissioners made a recommendation to take money out of Buy Fresh, Buy Local, and the assembly made the recommendation to put that back in. And I know that that program has a huge impact. I mean, everything you do, it has a huge impact in our communities. But so I do find it very challenging to go forward and just say, well, we're not gonna do anything. I would very much like to, well, I see another hand up. I think I'll wait until after Delegate Harder speaks. Go ahead, Delegate Harder.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just have a quick question for Pat about AmeriCorps. Do you think that the $6,000 that Lillianne put in, I mean, I know she feels this way and I feel this way, that it's very important for you to go to the National, you know, Trade Association meeting and get to know your peers and all that. Do you think it's as important as we do, or do you think you could miss a year?
Thank you very much for the question, Kat Garofoli, Program Manager for AmeriCorps Cape Cod. I would say that our participation in the national conference is really important. The last couple of years, due to COVID, the America's Service Commission has provided virtual options, so that may be the case that we could participate in next year virtually. I would say, if anything, instead of sending all three upper management staff, which would be myself and two program coordinators, maybe prioritizing just sending one person. The other sort of avenue is that part of the National Conference for AmeriCorps programs, there is a lot of fiscal grant compliance. So there may be an opportunity to in the future, look at our fiscal grant officer participating in that, not this year, but maybe next year. So I think that if we were given even a small opportunity to allocate some money towards that, just to send one program representative, I think that would be very valuable.
Thank you.
Right. From my perspective, it looks like perhaps some of the monies that I've proposed to put back the department will, Mr. McGuire and Kat both think that perhaps a portion of that would be helpful, if not all of it. And I think I don't want to play God with saying this goes back and that goes back. I think it needs further scrutiny. But if does the committee, how does the committee feel? How do the committee members feel with making a request for at least $100,000 to be evaluated and recommended to be put back into this budget? Anyone? Okay.
I am trying to raise my hand.
Okay, thank you. Delegate Gallagher, please.
I've given this some thought also, and I think it's important that we see it in the context of the overall budget picture. I think that Administrator Albert and her team have worked long and hard, including with all the department heads, that they have the big picture and that it is a year when some cuts are needed. I think that there will be opportunities for other funding through grants, et cetera. And I would be very reluctant to mess with that.
Even for the shellfish?
It's part of the big picture. I think the amount of money concerned is actually relatively small in the big picture, and people will make it up somehow. Where there's a will, there's a way, as Mr. McGuire said.
Okay. I saw that Delegate Harder's hand, Delegate Warner's hand was raised. Would you like to?
Yes, I do agree with my colleague, Delegate Gallagher, in the fact that there was a great deal of hard work done on this budget to bring to the commissioners and then, of course, to the assembly. I think that the having to pare it down a substantial amount of money has been a painful process for everyone. And there are going to be places where we're simply not going to be able to make it whole, if you will, and go forward. I do think that you know there are ways, as Director McGuire has pointed out, that people can try and look at other avenues to bring in those resources. For me, of all the areas that you have outlined so far, if there was only one that could be perhaps looked at to go back in, I think it would be the shellfish program because of its impact to all of the communities and its late impact in the season. I think that it makes it hard for towns at this point to, no matter how small the amount is, to try to figure out where they might cobble that from in order to be able to keep that program alive. And it's not just the economic value, it's also the environmental value that it has on our landscape and what that does for our Cape. And so I that would be for me at this point, if there was only one that we might be able to consider, that would be one that I would vote for.
Delegate Warner, would you vote for again, the Buy Fresh, Buy Local, and the people traveling? Well, you said the facility improved for AmeriCorps and people traveling to the national conference.
I would consider what Kat said about sending one person as opposed to three. So that would is a couple of thousand dollars to the national program for AmeriCorps. I think the Buy Fresh, Buy Local program was $10,000. If we could find that money, I think that would be something to consider as well. I am concerned about the reduction in the AmeriCorps building fund. But as I said, there's we can't recommend all things go back, and we can't, you know, juggle the budget around to a point where it's just a mixed up board at the end. I think that we have to be realistic and understand that not all of the programs can go through. So that would probably be where I would stop.
I just wanted to make one statement that the commissioners also flagged some of these items as well in their meeting. So they did to red flag the AmeriCorps and these other items that we're discussing this evening. Delegate, would you be amenable to recommending putting $75,000 back into this budget?
That might work. I'm wondering if our colleague if she can speak yet, or you know,
I don't. Can she? Yeah.
I believe she's on two ways. I can't hear her voice on the phone. It looks like her mic is muted. If you press star six, you should be able to unmute, Delegate.
Delegate Wyman Colombo. Can you speak?
Looks like not. We're going to have to get that sorted out.
Okay, we're running out of time. Okay. Would you care to make a motion? Delegate
Sure. I propose that we recommend to the Finance Committee that it look at putting $75,000 back into the, I guess it's the very specific items that we'll send. Okay.
I don't know if we want to go that far, but do we want to just put it back into the cooperative extension budget, and they can come back and figure that out. Is that okay? Is that okay with you?
Okay.
So the motion would be to put $75,000 back into the cooperative extension budget. Is that?
Yes.
And, is there a second, or shall I second it? I will second that. And she did tell me that she would have to sign off as Delegate Chafee did have to sign off. So, we can't hear how Delegate Wyman Colombo is gonna vote. I don't know if we need to. So, Mr. Clerk,
you still have a quorum, Chair, if Delegate Gallagher's here, so I can take a little call.
Right, and also, shall we include Delegate O'Malley and Delegate Katai in this vote to make five?
Can't do that now, I don't think, procedurally. You had a quorum at the start of the meeting that was not them, and so they can't participate in the vote, would be my sense.
Okay, so could you please call the roll for the vote?
Yes. Delegate Gallagher?
No.
Chair Green?
Yeah.
Delegate Warner?
Yes.
Delegate Chafee? Delegate Wyman Colombo? Madam, that motion does not pass.
Because? No. Why?
Well, you don't have a majority of the committee voting for the motion. There's only two people. You'd need a majority of the five members of the committee.
But we can't hear one of them. Can she vote one way or other? Is that possible? That she could vote
I can't get any indication. That would be my opinion as clerk. I do not believe you've got a majority of the committee voting, but I'm not sure what we can do.
Can I be helpful?
Yes.
Hello.
Hi. Can you hear me, Michaela?
Hi.
Hello. I don't think you can hear me.
I can hear her when she said hello.
Now I can.
Oh, good. Yeah, if there's any way they can hear you vote to put money back into the extension, they need to vote, if that's possible. They can't hear you. You're like muted on there.
I understand that. And what I've tried to do is I was in on my phone, star 6.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
And for some reason,
oh, okay. It'll get done. Speaker. Okay.
Is it possible that she can vote?
Yeah, maybe if you shut your cell phone off all the way and then turn it back on and try to join the next meeting. That's all I can think of.
Randy, can I ask you to ask her to just vote on the on this item?
Oh, because you know what? Michaela, can you hear me okay? They want to know if you want to vote to put $75,000 back into the budget for the extension. Can you hear me?
It sounds like you're underwater.
Okay, but if you vote on that right now, I can put the phone up and you can say yes or no about $75,000 for the extension. Does that work for you?
I'm sorry. Can't understand.
No, you can't hear me.
I hear it though it's underwater, so I can't understand what you're saying.
Okay.
Can she hear us on the meeting? Can she hear us?
Can you hear them at the meeting at all? Okay. Sure. Sorry. I'm going to hang up.
She can't hear us.
Sorry, folks. I did what I could.
Okay. Well, all right. I guess.
It'll be done. Yeah.
I guess that didn't work out as well as I thought it would, as far as everyone having a voice. So I apologize that Delegate Wyman Colombo was not able to hear us or to express her opinion, and that Vice Chair Chafee had to leave the meeting early. So with that, I'd like to call for adjournment. I guess we have to do that, right?
You've got we need a motion a second to adjourn because we're remote. So
moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Delegate Chafee? Delegate Gallagher?
Yes.
Chair Green?
Yes.
Delegate Warner?
Yes.
Delegate Wyman Colombo? Madam Chair, you're adjourned.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.